afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to open up a discussion on a very exciting area that's really powering biological sciences today. The topic that we have is to discuss how deep learning techniques are used in genomic research. And we'll also have a walkthrough to the basics and the fundamentals of genomics, which will be followed by a hands-on session here. So how many of you are aware of what's happening in the world of genomics? Why do you think genomics is important? It's something we would like to highlight before I begin the session. The buzzword called genomics, which is something all biologists, mathematicians, computational biologists today use extensively, and have really made an impact by analyzing this data in the case of therapy as well as diagnosis, is being revolutionized over the past 10 years or so, mainly when the concept of next generation sequencing came into the field. What is this genomics actually? The buzz started somewhere in 2001 when the first draft of the human genome was released, further with additions in 2003. When we figured out the first ever mystery that the nucleus of every cell, which has the DNA, which is 1 meter to 1.5 meters long, is made up of 3.3 billion base pairs. It's a hell of a lot of information. It's such a lot of information that encoding what this information means to us is a huge challenge which involved computational biologists, which is a hybrid of the real computer science people with a lot of mathematics expertise. That's when a lot of algorithms, physicochemical properties, computing came into biology. Today we are in a very advanced stage to understand these techniques. To understand first what a genome is before we even start using the buzzword, a genome is just a representative word for the entire DNA that cells. If you look at the cell, a eukaryotic cell, which is what you and I have, it's made up of a membrane and a nucleus, which contains the entire DNA that we talk about. We think that the entire information that we hold is encoded in the DNA of the genome. The entire stretch of DNA, which is what I said, 3.3 billion base pairs, is what you call by the buzzword genome. If I'm able to extract the protein information and get at the protein, I call it a proteome. We will later talk about something called exome in the session. So this large genome, how does it actually make? There is a very big size problem. The nucleus is just 10 micron, where we are trying to put in a 1.5 meter long DNA. It first goes through a base pairing. It's a double-stranded helix. It's just a polymer of phosphodiester backbones made up of sugar and phosphate, with the inner lining being composed of four different chemical structures. These are the four letters that we are made up of: A, T, G, and C, the adenine, thymine, cytosine, and the guanine, which we are made of. A beautiful double helical structure, an asymmetrical structure, as you see, this is not symmetrical, an anti-parallel arrangement, very geometrically and beautifully arranged structure, which then folds onto certain proteins called histones, forms a nucleosome, compacts itself, makes its way into the nucleus. How this makes it into the nucleus and how it's regulated is the most exquisite machinery that nature has designed. Man cannot make a machine to analyze this exquisite design till today. So the genome that we talk about, coming to today's problem, is made up of A, T, G, and C, and we are going to call these bases. And how do these bases sit? If you revisit the last slide, the A and the T together can be connected by hydrogen bonds. So can the G and C. The connection between the A and T or the G and C is what I call base pairing. I'm pairing the bases together either through a double bond or a triple bond or a stronger hydrogen bond formation so they are not broken. That is the unit by which we are going to measure the genome. Later we can convert it into nanometer scale, angstrom scale, meter scales. But the unit as I walk into the genome is always base pair. That is why when you ask me the length of the genome, it's always said 3.3 billion base pairs. I could then convert into nanometer when I do the amino acid calculations here. Now, how is this regulated? There are multiple steps by which these can be regulated. The first ever step that we are, I would come a little later into why we are using this for deep learning, why we are using deep learning here. As I told you, one, I would request that you remember two terms called the 5 prime and the 3 prime. When I refer to the 5 prime, I refer to a phosphate. When I refer to a 3 prime, I refer to an hydroxyl group here. They come and do the base pairing. Always the adenine A pairs with T and G always pairs with C. This is how the arrangement is made. And you see that this goes from 3 prime to 5 prime while the other goes from 5 prime to 3 prime on a very complementary fashion that they stack together over this on a very beautiful geometry that it can build. So, as I make my way through, I'm talking about a single stretch of DNA. And the whole world knows that it is a double-stranded DNA, which makes it, today we are talking about four-stranded DNA and wonder DNA from which we are able to make materials also. We'll come to this during the discussion part. So this DNA is not a static material. We can call it the building block, we can call it the blueprint of information, but this is exactly where information is packed. All that information which has to help us move functionally, which helps every biochemical reaction in the cell, which decides cellular pathways, which decides development, which decides diseases, which decides well-being, which decides character, all the information is packed. But how does information flow inside? The DNA cannot cannot be functional explicitly like this. It has to undergo two different processes, which is beautifully called the central dogma of life. This DNA, I think I can be heard without a mic.
You can use a hand mic.
The DNA has to first make what is called an mRNA. And DNA is a deoxyribonucleic acid, and RNA is a ribonucleic acid, which is very familiar from our earlier classes. It has to first make an mRNA through a process called transcription. I transcribe and then translate to make a protein, which are the actual energy units. So when I make a transcription, it happens in the natural way that we transcribe. The DNA, as we know, is a double strand. There are many types of RNA. It can be a messenger RNA, which carries the message. It can be a transfer RNA, which transfers and helps in the synthesis of protein. Different RNAs function at different stages. So just for you to understand the workshop, we are laying the fundamentals here. During a transcription process, which is the coding of this DNA strip into an mRNA strip, an RNA is different only in the case where the T is replaced by U. It's a uracil. And from the transcript, it starts synthesizing the proteins that we require for function inside the cells. That process is what you call translation. The DNA to mRNA flow is affected by something called an RNA polymerase. It's an enzyme. The RNA to protein is enabled by something called a ribosome. I do not know how many of you remember Venki Ramakrishnan's Nobel Prize was on the crystal structure of the ribosome complex at the MRC called Cambridge, where they spent several decades to arrive at the complex structure. Still, it's not fully derived. So from there, if you look at it beautifully, a gene is just a stretch of DNA. And as I start transcribing, I'm a double helical structure. I have to first unwind for me to be copied and transcribed. As I unwind and the enzyme starts walking across, it encounters two sites. One is called a promoter and the other is called a terminator. I should first know where to start and I should know where to end. That's a terminator. This is a promoter which initiates this. But as I walk through, I get through what is called exonic region, which is a coding region, regions that can code, and regions which cannot be coded to a protein or the mRNA. These are called intron, as we know, these are interrupting regions. And these need to be spliced because as I go through, they are not conserved. They may cross mistakes in making the protein, which is the root cause of diseases. So these have to be spliced by a mechanism called splicing. And then this happens in the nucleus. The picture now moves into the cytoplasm, where with the ribosome, with the tRNA, the ribosome walks through this and makes the process. pre-RNA is spliced, all modifications are made, and in the cytoplasm, the protein is actually made. Now, Jyoti will continue on what codons and other things. Before that, the question is now, why would you ever talk about this in connection to deep learning? As I sequence this long strip, I can sequence it at the level where the transcription has happened or at the level of DNA. In doing so, there is a large heterogeneity, there is a huge data, and the data is quite complex because of its heterogeneity that statistical models or other traditional algorithmic tools cannot detail it. And the mathematical modeling is not something it can quickly learn from because many of these sequencing methods are based on cohorts of 10,000 or 20,000 people, so there is a large heterogeneity of data. If at all there is a big data in any field, it is in genomics. It's a very, very data-driven science. Because of the complexity of the data, pairwise correlations are not easy. Statistical visualizations are not so easy. So therefore, predictive models are to be used. And the best of the predictive models which are coming to capture today are the deep learning models, mainly because the abstraction of mathematical modeling comes and feeds into this genomic data. After Jyoti finishes her part, we'll come back and explain more about where deep learning is applied in this. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Vijayalakshmi. Yeah, so what you have learned is the basic. Many of the things didn't penetrate. If you're new to biological sciences, many things you could capture. So you know that DNA, what we all hold, is a kind of, you know, puzzle in a puzzle in a puzzle. Okay, the whole idea is how do you, if you want to implement or you want to bring this data into a numerical format so that you can do deep learning and all that, you should have a dictionary for that, right? So the whole idea is we are trying to condense what you have learned till now. How do we transform this into a statistical data set? What is your classical data set? You have number of rows, number of columns. You need your data to be, so if you tell a machine learning model this, it won't understand. It has to be rightly translated. So all of us carry a dictionary. Our genes or genome, complete makeup of a person, the complete DNA present in your body is genome, right? So we have a dictionary that's called DNA codon table. So, but don't mistake that the same table or the same dictionary holds good for other organisms, for microorganism and all. It's a different dictionary. But for eukaryotes, we carry only one single dictionary, and this dictionary can be seen in this. So this diagram has to be read from inside out. Yes, for example, I have a sequence that's a simple sequence. Always a protein starts with ATG. Okay, as she said, the transcription has to start somewhere, end somewhere. So we always know there's a termination codon at the end, and the starting is always ATG. ATG means a methionine. If you just read it, ATG, methionine. So we are all composed of our proteins are permutation combination of 20 amino acids. The basic structure of a protein is amino acid. So for example, you take an insulin molecule. If you write it in the amino acid fashion, it will look like that. But you have to take it into your columns. How do you take it into columns? You say 30 glycine, 44 alanines. So you get your variables. Yes, for each sample, you are getting your X variable. That is your independent variables. Taking this, the composition of 20 amino acid. I'll be talking about later about this, but I just wanted to see that how we connect biological information to your computer or your modeling kind of environment. Have you heard of genetic algorithm? It is inspired by evolution, what is happening to our race, that is human race. See, it is common knowledge that we have evolved from chimpanzee, okay? So over the years, what has happened is, each generation, the input of gene pool is changing. We are evolving. We evolved from chimpanzee to what we are today. Our evolution is still going on. So we don't know where our evolution is going to take us. But this process is, you can actually mirror what's happening in evolution in this algorithm. You can talk, I don't want to spend too much time here. It's only thing is, let's look at. We know all of us have 23 pairs of chromosomes. We know our genetic composition. One pair comes from your father, other pair comes from mother. They talk to each other. And see what happens in your lifetime. There are a lot of things you are exposed to environment. You are exposed to many things. So you start your life with your base genome. Then whatever you encounter, that gets encoded in your genome in the form of mutations. There are different things happening in the mutations. Every cell has a shelf life. So there's a lot of wear and tear of your body. So every cell, when it is getting replaced, it has to duplicate. It has to copy. So during the copy, there's a possibility that there's some errors there. For example, when you're transferring information from one form to another form, there's always a possibility of error. So the whole thing, throughout your lifetime, your cells are dividing. At every instance, there's a possibility that there's errors introduced. The errors can be of different types, different classes. Okay, these errors are called mutations. Mutations, deletions. They can be deletion in the sense some part of your genome gets deleted. So the deletion can be small length, big length, medium length, you don't know. It can be of variation. Okay, duplication. There's a possibility during the copying, the same information is copied many times. So that is also a mutation. That is an error. That is not exactly the reference copy what we got. Inversion, the gene gets inverted. See, for example, chromosome 4 and chromosome 20. Imagine a bit of chromosome 4 goes and gets attached to chromosome 20. This, what is happening? The insertion is interchromosome, not just intrachromosome, it's interchromosome. Then there is a translocation, as I was telling, that bit of one chromosome goes and sits. So there can different kind of things happening in your dictionary, your gene dictionary. At every point, things are happening. What is cancer? Cancer is nothing but when these errors all together becomes deleterious. They become reach a saturation point that it is going to bring in a physiological change in your body. Tumor develops. What is tumor? Nothing but unnatural division of cells. Why it happens? Who dictates it? This mutation dictates. Yeah, this mutations can be of three types. Missense. It doesn't make sense. If a gene sequence doesn't make sense, you won't have a protein. If you don't have a protein, your physiological activity of that specific protein gets stopped. Yes, so what happens? Your body, you have those symptoms, many kind of symptoms, it can be anything. So silent mutation. The mutation has occurred, but the outcome is nothing. It is not making any change to your physiological activity. Those mutations are called silent mutation. Nonsense, very dangerous. In a dictionary, if in our gene dictionary, if you get a mutation which is nonsense, you have a nonsense protein that may just haphazardly make all your reactions, make all your physiological reaction go in a state where you get any kind of, it can result into any kind of failure. And what a gene mutation, you're gathering mutation your lifetime, but only it gets transmitted from one generation to another generation, only the mutation occurs in germline. Germline mutation is basically where it's going to get into the next generation. It can be sperm cell or it can be egg cell. If there's a mutation in there, then it's surely getting translated to your next generation. I'm just giving you a kind of a, in a sentence way, in a format of a sentence, what happens when there's a mutation happening. See, the top sequence is a normal gene, then you have a point mutation. So as the man saw the dog hit the can, end. As the man saw the dot hit the can, okay, it will have a consequence in your body. Then deletion, as a man saw the hit the can, the word gone. As the man saw the fat dog hit the can, there's an insertion. It is making a different meaning. Imagine there's a frame shift. The whole genome chromosome starting point from one to the end, there is a meaning to it. If anything happens, anything, the three, I think I wanted to bring in another thing. Three nucleotides, triplets, get into encoded into one amino acid, right? Imagine one or two amino acids go. One amino acid means there are three nucleotides go missing. If it is two amino acids, it will be six words missing. Your frame gets shifted. What is the meaning of the sentence? As the man saw the, can you read the sentence? No. So these kind of mutations are occurring day to day. Every time you are exposed to something which is harmful, like UV rays. You get cancer when you are exposed to high UV rays, right? So this is what happens with a single mutation. In cystic fibrosis, have you heard of cystic fibrosis? Very dangerous. What has changed? One pair of AT has changed to CG. That's it. Single point mutation and causes. Imagine all the organs go into a state of shock and it causes so much problem that person cannot lead a safe life. How do you detect mutation? We understood type of mutation. Let's look how to detect. So we have some packages in like BioPython where you can actually compare sequences and understand where the mutation has occurred and how do you classify them. So let's look at pairwise sequences. There are a lot of bioinformatic tools also, and you can also do that in your Python with using BioPython. So imagine if you are matching two sequences, what are you looking for? You're looking for match value. A match, one nucleotide matching with the reference is good. Yes, that's what we want. A mismatch, C should always go with, C should go with G. C should go with G. What has happened there? T, it's a mismatch. So your model should be able to catch this. What happened to gap? There should be a G, what has happened? C. No. G, nothing. Missing. The nucleotide has dropped down. So when you're doing a pairwise sequence, a pairwise alignment, you look for these three things. Match, good point. Mismatch, not good point. Gap, very bad. Do you understand? Because our genes are read in triplets.
any word drops in that triplet is bad. Yeah. So we do the penalty. If you want, you remember gradient descent, you have local alignment, you have global alignment. Same thing you can also match when you're looking for pairwise sequence alignment. You have global alignment, local alignment, and you have to, we come up with a score. So what happens is you have list of mutations and you have independent variables. You can, there you can say how many mismatches, how many matches, how many gene penalty, that means gap penalty. So you can also have a another independent variable which talks about type of mutation when you do reference sequences. You'll ask where you get the reference sequence. There is a reference sequence. Have you heard of Genome Project, which went on for 20 years to map one single genome? Now we are in such a state that we can actually do one single genome in 24 hours. When we started, we were in that state that we took 20 years to map one genome. But the evolution in genomic research and application has gone to such an extent that you can, morning you give your blood, genome is, you can easily get your genetic material. Just take 5 ml of blood, your DNA is extracted from that. We have different techniques to do duplication, and then you can map it. Within 24 hours, you get a gene card where all your 23 chromosomes are given. What is the state? At that point, your body is always evolving. If you do the gene scanning for yourself today, it won't be the same in 1 year time or 10 days, because your body is changing, right? So you can, do you understand now how we can convert what we have done in the sequence alignment into a matrix which forms your deep learning basis, right? You can, as I spoke about pairwise, we are actually doing only two sequences pairing. You can do at a time, multiple. Okay, so you can collect blood from 50 candidates and do the mutation for single gene. You want to see who has a mutation, who doesn't have a mutation. At the same time, you can do multiple sequence alignment. We have such some of the tools which I have mentioned here, Cluster Omega and all, which you can do it. They are bioinformatic tools. They are not your modeling tool, but you can get your independent variables. So there's something called T-cafe. So whatever, whether you have a protein molecule, RNA molecule, DNA molecule, it'll give you, it does multiple alignment and gives you the scores, which becomes your independent variable. We will today in hands-on, we are going to typically look at one example where we have taken 50 DNA sequences of 50 base length, right? And we have a label. The label, we have got it using NSA. So we already have its label data. You take the label data, run your CNN, RNN, and you get a confusion matrix. You can evaluate it based on that. And you can make a classifier. Okay, for that gene, you have taken 50 samples, you have made a classifier. Now, when you have next 50 sample, you don't have to label it, right? Because your label or classifier is already ready using the 50. So you don't have to do this assay, but taking this as a model, you can label the next 50. Don't you think that is something which is reducing your time, energy, resource? So we need those classifiers. Have you heard of BRCA gene? Has anybody heard of BRCA gene? It's a breast cancer gene. It's the first cancer which we can easily detect today. There are so many cancers, it's very difficult to detect early because problem. What happens is we're still in such a place that we don't know many of the cancers because cancer occurs in a different variation. Breast cancer can have many variants of that. So it's not easy to map one type cancer type to mutation. Mutation can be many. For example, two people having breast cancer, if you do a same gene, BRCA gene, if you map it, the mutation will be so different. We all differ by variation. How much variation do you think each one of you differ by the 1%? We all look so different. But what is the change? Only 1%. But that 1%, you don't know where it is. Okay. We are differing from each other only by 1%, but that variation is different to different. So do you understand our population carries so much of variation, so many different formats of variations, and that's why we look, our personalities are so different, everything's reflected what we are built on, right? So this is what, this is how you translate the codonic or your genomic information into machine learning data set. You have not yet done it, but for example, this is a very simple case. So Usha will walk through the notebooks, how we have done, so that if you have any questions after the notebooks, we'll talk about it. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, hi, good afternoon everyone, thanks for coming. And so for the next 30 to 45 minutes we'll have hands-on coding session, and I'm not sure if my I would like to introduce myself and first a few more introductory talk. Like it's a great privilege to present along with two people who have achieved a lot in genomics, Dr. Jyothirmayee and Dr. Vijayalakshmi Mahadevan ma'am. And thank you for, I would like to thank Dr. Jyothirmayee for helping me coach throughout the duration of this. And Dr. Viji ma'am has been inspiring me to achieve more and more push boundaries, and she has been guiding me throughout my career, in all walks. So thank you both of you. And I'm a principal data scientist for Mysuru Consulting Group. And I'm also the chapter lead for Bengaluru Women in Machine Learning and Data Science. And three parts. So the three parts to hands-on. First off, Dr. Jyothi would have told you about the sequence alignment, match, mismatch, and all that. So that will be the first part. And the second part is we would have taken a simulated data set of 50 bases alone, just for the sake of understanding. And we'll be finding out whether the 50 bases will bind to a protein or not. If it's binding to a protein, it is 1. And if it's not binding, it's marked as 0. So this will be the second hands-on. And the third hands-on is about an assignment in cancer genomics. So we'll come back to it. And getting started.
Okay, this is the demo which I'm going to take. I'm going to take a sample DNA text file, and then I'm going to do both this global alignment and local alignment. So the formula, the score, how it is calculated is this. So it takes the maximum similarity between the sequence X and Y, and the formula for it is how much of it is matching into 1, and how much of it is mismatching. We don't, because we only want the maximum similarity, we're not bothered about the mismatch and the gap. So this is a formula. I'm going to show you how it can be done using a package called BioPython. First part of the hands-on will be how to convert a DNA into protein sequence. So a sample DNA text file is given. This is your input. So I'll show you how the sample DNA text file looks like. Okay, this is your sample DNA text file. I'm just going to take every 3 letters, and then I'm going to encode it into a protein sequence. So conversion of DNA sequence into protein is the first step. So this is your sample text file. and I'm going to walk you through the code. So I'm taking an input, as I showed you the sample input, how it looks like. That is my input. I'm reading that file. And then this is my codon table. Dr. Jyothi would have explained to you about the codon table. So you're taking, this is like a blueprint for every three characters, what does it map onto? So this is my codon table, and I just generate a protein sequence. So for the sample sequence, which I'm just printing out the sample sequence and the generated protein sequence for that. So this is the first part subset of the notebook. And then I'm installing a package called BioPython. She would have showed you about the sequence alignment, global alignment, and the local alignment. So in BioPython, we have got packages to do it. We just have to pass the sequences, and the the function does the job for us. So you're importing a package called from Bio. You're importing pairwise too, and there is a method called align.globalxx, and you're passing x and y sequence to it, and it will automatically give you the score. And so this is a score 3 for all these three things it's giving you. So you have to call the method and then pass the x and y sequence. The job will be done. And so for local alignment, again, it is align.localxx, where you have to pass the x and y sequence, and you'll be able to get a score. So this is the first part of the hands-on. So I'll just quickly summarize what has been done in this notebook. You're taking a sample DNA text, then you're converting it to a protein sequence. That's what I did first. And then she had explained in the slides how to calculate the global alignment and local alignment. She had put the formulas and she had given the theory explanation for it. We're using a package called BioPython and the method, and we're passing the X and Y sequence as an input parameter, and output is we're getting the score. So this is a walkthrough of the first notebook. So the theory part, okay, the introduction part, she had explained in the last slide what is the hands-on we're going to do. So we have to, so we are taking a simulated data set of a DNA sequence of 50 bases. I'll show you how the input looks like now. So this is a simulated data set of 50 bases. So what I have to do is I have to classify whether this will bind to a protein or not. If it's going to bind to a protein, I'll have to classify it as 1. And if it's not binding to a protein, it's classified as 0. So this is the job. And I'm going to use deep learning architecture, a basic CNN architecture, to get this job done. So there are 4 steps. First, we curate the data, which we have got now. And then we select an architecture. The architecture which we are showing for the sake of simplicity to be able to handle, accommodate all types of audiences, we have chosen a simple model and we have used simple hyperparameters. But the code will be shared with you. You are free to experiment with all types of hyperparameters and you can do all the complex optimizations above it. We're just giving you a simple walkthrough. And first getting the data, then choosing an architecture, then evaluate and train, and then interpreting. These are the 4 steps. So I'm just printing out first 5 lines of my data. This is how it looks like. So what I'm going to do is, first step, I'm going to convert the labels into integers. That is my first step. And once I convert it into integers, I'm going to do one hot sequence. For each of the nucleotide, A, C, T, G, you have to convert it, you have to make one hot sequence of it. So there are two steps into it. So this block of code, first it converts it into a sequence of integers, and then it converts it into a one hot sequence. So I'm just printing out the sample, how it looks like. Yeah, A, C, T, G. For A, it will be, hope everyone understands one hot encoding. So for A, wherever A is present, it will be marked as 1, and for rest of the things, it will mark as 0. And for each of the nucleotide, you do that. No, for the value it is present, it will be marked as 1, and rest everything will be marked as 0. So first step, you convert it into integers, and then do the one-hot encoding. This is the format we want the data into. So you do the pre-processing up to this step. So you're going to select the architecture. As I already told you, this is a very simple architecture to accommodate all of you. We have used a very simple CNN architecture. So there are four layers into it. The first layer is a convolutional layer, convolutional 1D layer. We have 32 filters of size 12 bases. And then we have a max pooling layer, 1D layer. So we're just using it as a non-linear downsampling, but it's not necessary, but it's an optional layer. And then flatten layer will flatten the results of this max 1 pooling 1D layer. And in dense, we have two dense layers. The first dense layer will convert it into a 16 tensors, and the second one will convert it into a two possible output. The output is 0 or 1, right? Whether it will bind to a protein or not bind to a protein, it is 0. So this is the architecture, simple convolutional 1D. And then we have the max pooling 1D for providing the non-linear downsampling. And then flatten layer for flattening the output, whatever is coming out of the max pooling 1D. And in dense, we have two things. First, we convert it into a layer of 16 tensors. And then you're again converting into a tensor. Of final output is 0 or 1. So this is a very simple convolutional 1D architecture, which I'm going to use for the problem. So I'm training my model. I'm giving my input train features and train labels. And then printing out. I'm trying to calculate the precision recall values. This is my confusion matrix, how much of it is correctly predicted and how much of it is a misclassification. You can get the insights from the confusion matrix. So this is the end of the first notebook. So basically what I'm doing in this entire notebook is, the overview of it is, I'm taking a DNA sequence of 50 bases and trying to classify if that will bind to a protein or not. And what I'm using is a simple 1D convolutional layer. So for this process, I have to convert it into a format which I can give it as an input to the convolutional layer. So it is in, first off, it is in alphabets, right? So you'll have to convert it into an integers. After you convert it into an integers, you have to apply one hot encoding. Now you will get the format in which you can feed it as an input to the architecture which we designed. And then the output of the architecture is going to be 0 or 1. So this is a very simple task which Dr. Jyothi explained this task. We have done it in deep learning. So it's a very simple thing. Now we'll go for the other second example, which is the proposal, whatever is in our proposal. We started at 1:45, so till how long is it? Another 45 minutes we have. right. So the problem statement is a cancer tumor will have, you know, whatever type of cancer you have, breast cancer or whatever, skin cancer, whatever types of cancer you have. It will be caused by several types of mutations, genetic mutations. So whenever you have a mutation, I think the theory of mutation and all of it, both Dr. Jyothi and G ma'am have explained. So when you have a mutation, there is some genetic variation which has caused the mutation. So for a clinician to be able to manually go through it and identify it, it's going to take a longer time. So we can do it very easily with deep learning. So they have to like go and read through a different text and then classify whether the class of mutation is going to be 1 to 9, and 9 is for the deleterious mutations and for a class, and as you go up higher, 1, 2, 3 are not the dangerous ones. So for a clinician to be able to do this, it's going to be a lot of process. We can do this very easily in machine learning. So I'm going to show you what is the input and what is the output we are getting. So we have two data sets. We have taken, since genomic data is always huge, so we have taken a very subset of it. For you to be able to understand the hands-on, we have taken a subset of it, but this not generally looks like. So yeah, first I'll start with showing you how the input data looks like. So we have two data sets which we have to combine. So this particular CSV file has got three columns. One is the gene, and then there's a variation, and there's a class. Class is the target variable, 1 to 9. So 9, 8, 9, 7, 8, 9 are the deleterious type of class, and the 1, 2, 3 is like not that dangerous. So our job is to predict this class. So this is the input. So you've got gene, you've got variation, and then you've got the class. Class is going to be your target variable. So there's one more Excel sheet. For each of the class, for each of the ID, you have the text available. So whether what type of mutation it is, you know, something which will give you more insight to classify it as a dangerous or non-dangerous. So you have a text attached to it. So these two are two different data sets. First thing, our job is to merge these two data sets. That's the first job. So ID is a common variable between the two data sets. I'll just show the data sets again. So this is my first data set, which has the gene, variation, and class. And ID is a common variable between the two data sets. So for each of the ID corresponding, there's a theory part text as well, describing more about it. So the metric which we're going to use is multi-class log loss and confusion matrix. So we are going to differentiate between the performance of different machine learning algorithms using these two metrics. So any time you run a machine learning algorithm, you have to be clear on what is the metric, what is the input you're getting, and what is the output you're getting. Sorry. So I import all the necessary packages installed for the process which I'm going to execute. Then I read the training data and just I print the first 5 rows of the first data set which I showed you. Then I print the first 5 rows of the second data set which I showed you. I'm going to concatenate both of the data sets, which now as the correspondent, these two data sets are merged together now. I'm ensuring I bring the class to the end because that's my target variable. So I'm dividing my data set into test training, training data set. Then I'm keeping 60% for training, and I'm keeping across 20% for validation and 20% for final testing. So to avoid overfitting, I divide into three groups of sets: test, training, validation, and tested. That's what this piece of code does. So one more thing is when you divide into, generally it is like sometimes it is test or training data set. When you see, you'll have to see the distributions of the various classes. You have classes from 1 to 9, right? So the distribution should be equal in all three data sets which you have kept across, test, training, and the validation. The distribution of the 9 classes of things should be, in all the 9 classes should be the same. So that is something which you have to put caution into while you divide into three types. So I'm going to visualize it, and I'm going to show you the visualization that in whatever I did, all the three distribution is same. So this is the distribution of class labels in training data. If you see the classes 1 to 9. So the dangerous ones are the 8 and 9, which are like we have few in number, and we have the highest one is the 7th. And so this is my distribution of class labels in training data. So I'm going to say we have the similar distribution of class labels in validation data as well. If you see 8 and 9 have the lower number and the 7 is the highest. And we are checking out the distribution of class labels in test data set. From now, what we are concluding is we saw the distribution of labels in training, validation, and test. We found out that all the distribution in all three data sets, we have the similar distribution. So now we are good to go. The next step. This is a check you need to put caution on and ensure it's proper. So before you start testing it out on different machine learning models, you just want, if you want, this is an optional step. If you want, you can just do what is a random guess, like how good is a random prediction. So you shouldn't have a model which does performs worse than a random prediction, right? So if you want to do that, you can do a testing of how good a random model is. So this is an option, so I'm skipping this part. So a little bit of exploratory analysis of how many types of unique genes we have and what are the categories so that we understand the data set much more better. This is for your better understanding of the data set. We are going to just do a univariate analysis of gene feature. This is exploratory analysis for you to get a closer connection with your data set before we jump on to the actual machine learning model, okay? So the two important things we are going to do, one is univariate analysis on gene feature, and we'll also be doing an analysis on the text data which we had a later part. So what does this show is number of unique genes we have is 231, and the different categories we have, BRCA1 is for breast cancer. And there are different types of things and how many of it is actually present. So this is what you get to know from the training data. Then you just plot a histogram, visualize whatever we saw it before. You're just doing a histogram of it, number of occurrences, and you have 231 genes, right? you're just plotting an index of the gene will go up to 231, and the number of occurrences of it, you're just drawing a histogram. This is just an exploratory analysis before you get to the model. You're doing a cumulative plot above it. That's it. There are two features which we will be using for comparison is alpha and log loss. So the one we are, we should pick up the one with the lowest alpha, log loss. We should like look for the lowest log loss value and the corresponding alpha of it. So featureizing the gene, there are two steps to it. First one, you do response coding, and then you do a one-hot coding. You see your, you know, the context of this after one-hot coding is not lost. Sometimes, you know, you might lose certain context after doing one-hot coding. So you have to ensure you have not lost the context. So that is what I'm checking in this entire piece of code. If I have lost any context of the data after doing one-hot coding. So first thing is the response coding. And then I'm printing out the distribution of features there, size of it. And then I'm doing vectorizing it. And then I'm printing out the shape and the details. We have not lost the context. I'm printing out the alpha and log loss. This is about the univariate analysis of gene feature. We'll also be doing a univariate analysis of the text feature as well. So there we were doing response coding and one-hot encoding for the gene feature. So for the univariate analysis of text feature, we are doing as response coding and TF-IDF. After you do response coding and TF-IDF, you just have to ensure you're printing the alpha versus log loss, and then you have to ensure the distribution of words is also the distribution of frequency of words across the three data sets are also similar. So that also is one of the caution check which you have to do. So this part of code does that. And now you finally come to building machine learning models. So there are several models which we have tried out tried testing this use case. And first we started with, I'll just show you a quick summary of the several models which we tested out. The metrics we are comparing each models in the beginning I had told you, multi-class log loss, and there was another metric which we were, confusion matrix. These are the two metrics which we used to compare across the several machine learning models which we tested on. And what are the results, which model in our analysis performed better in this job? Which is it? Yeah. Text data, I'm doing a TF-IDF for it. Right? You are converting it to some numeric format which you can do the analysis as. You can't use the text data into the, feed the text data into the model, right? Converting it to. Yeah, you're using text data as features as well. Text data doesn't have labels at all. So there is a particular part which I've skipped on. Like there is a little bit of explanation which has to be done on the text data part, which I've actually skipped on for the sake of time. We'll be sharing the code, which you can do. You will be able to see what are the different processes which we have done the text data on. After TF, IDF, there's a longer part involved as well. There is what from our analysis we found out stack classifier performs has got the lowest log loss and it performs better than the other models. And so, for this use case, we took a subset of huge data and we tried out various machine learning algorithms. Our job was to find out from which class of we have to identify the class labels, which of the class labels it falls under. So that was our target variable, and we tried doing this under several machine learning algorithms, and we found out stack classifier performs better. So I'll go through again. So this was the second use case which we were dealing with. So we had three walkthrough of the code. The first thing was to like convert a DNA into a protein sequence. That was our first thing. And then doing pairwise sequence alignment, global alignment and local alignment. And the second use case which we dealt with was given a sample DNA file. You have to predict whether it binds to a protein or doesn't bind to a protein. If it binds to a protein, it's going to be one. You're just doing a simple classification using a simple 1D convolutional architecture. And then the second use case which we dealt was personalized cancer diagnosis. So in this, our input was like, so if you have a cancer tumor, there would have been several mutations which would have caused it. For each of the mutation, there'd be like a genetic variation. A clinician has to manually identify from which particular mutation this genetic variation has come. So we are simplifying the process of a clinician by using a machine learning algorithm. The clinician doesn't have to do manually all the searching and reading of all the documents and text and all of it. So this process is simplified by using all these applying machine learning algorithms. This is an input and this was the output. And so the output target variable was our class labels, so 1 to 9. So it's different class labels, so 8, 9, 7 are all little dangerous, and the up above the order 1, 2, 3 are not that dangerous ones. So these are the three case studies and walkthrough of the code. We will be sharing the code in the proposal, so if it is like a very short time to grasp all of it. So we'll share the code, you can go home and have a read through it, and if you still have doubts, you can always get back to me. So the end of the hands-on. And over to Dr. Jyothi. There's a little bit of theory part elsewhere left. So I'll give it to her.
Thank you, Usha. Yeah, the whole idea is you understood what we do in a genomics research. If you want to use a deep learning network or deep learning modeling, any kind, we know how to translate biological information into numerical information and do all this. But do you know why we are doing? Is it so necessary? So the whole idea is why. We want to, have you heard of a term called precision medicine? Yeah? The whole problem here is whatever we are doing at present, it's not working. In case of cancer itself, we have different types of cancer, and different types of cancer has different nature. So we are still unable to classify the cancers properly. We are not able to, that means whatever we are doing, it's not affecting. It's not very effective. And in the coming days, we have to take a different strategy. What is the different strategy? Till now, we go to a doctor, whatever is happened to you, you go to a doctor, he or she diagnoses, you take the medicine. But what we have seen is, it's not effective. That treatment is not effective. The second is personalized medicine or precision medicine. what is precision medicine? It's nothing but you're going to take data from all possibility, your case history, whatever you have come, whatever has happened to you from your childhood till now, your biochemical test, you do all kind of biochemical tests, right? You check your urine, you do blood samples, you do check for thyroid, take all that information. If you have broken bones, you would have taken x-ray, take that x-ray. Okay, put all of them, plus your genomic data. You put together, so what happens, this data, when it goes to a doctor, doctor can make an informed decision. He's looking at your history, clinical history, he knows what has happened in physiologically, and plus he is adding genomic data to it, or genomic knowledge to it. So he's coming up with a medicine which is so personalized that it'll be effective and it is a better treatment. So the whole idea why we want to convert genomic understanding into your machine learning is whole idea is to go towards precision medicine. So tomorrow, everyone, as I told you, your genome can be mapped within 24 hours. Genomic the sequencing machines or sequencing technology has come to such a place where you can map your genome within 24 hours. You know how much does it cost to map your genome? Anybody has any idea? $100. It has come down to $100. So very soon it's going to be such affordable situation where you can map your genome and you will carry your genome in a pocket. It'll be in like a gene card. You go to a doctor, what are you going to do? Everything is stored in your card. Just give that card. The doctor is going to put it in the system, he'll read and he's able to easily diagnose for whatever trouble you go, he or she can easily diagnose, because the person has on his or her fingertips these things, all what is being collected, what has happened to you. So don't you think that's a right way to treat? You won't have failure for, let me give you an example. My father had a chronic heart attack. Okay, so the doctors gave blood thinners. Yeah, that's what happens when you have a blood clot in your heart, they give blood thinners. You know, my father was of that 1% population who react allergically towards that blood thinner, and he couldn't be saved. But if this technology or this knowledge was there, or this state was there, maybe he would have not suffered. So the whole idea is, how do we smoothen, streamline our treatment strategies? The way we diagnose, the way we detect disease, early detection of cancer, which is what we are striving today. At present, we don't detect cancer very early. We detect cancer at the last stage, or the stage where the person cannot be in a stage to be treatable. So we want to go to a place where we can do the early detection. See, there are a lot of markers genes. Okay, if you just study those genes throughout your lifetime, you can say that who has a propensity towards cancer, who has a propensity to some other disease. The whole idea is we want to revolutionize the way the treatment happens, and the way forward is doing this. And why at this juncture we are doing all this? The why is our sequence strategy or technology has to come to a certain stage that you can collect the data. So a lot of data. Your data science needs a lot of data, a lot of variation. Each of us has so many variation. We are collecting variation every day to whatever we are doing, any activity. So we have to map our genome, and this is the way forward. And the data, genomic data, is very complex. As I told you, we have spoken is only 1% of what we have learned. There's so much complexity to our DNA. So our data sets are broad. They are not tall, they are broad. They are multi-class, multi-label. So how do we do? Then when it comes to a hands-on molecular biologist or a clinician, he's not able to read. There are too many columns. How are you going to, can you do that? We used bioinformatic tools, but bioinformatic tool, with the flood of data coming very soon, bioinformatics is not accurate. It is slow, and it is not going to give. The person has to spend a lot of time. It's tedious. So how do you reduce the workload of that clinician, and how do you make things faster so that the information is in the hand of the practitioner
and that and you are getting the benefit out of it. So that's why we are doing all this, and this is a high time that all the computational, we need the computational expertise or the brains to put in this. See, for example, I'm a molecular biologist. Till now, past 2 years, I've started data science. I'm not that strong when it comes to modeling and all that. I have to struggle sometimes, but I'm very good in my domain. So if somebody supplements to my domain expertise, it's much faster and it's going to be smoother. So the whole idea is, this is the right time we do this. And I hand over to Vijayalakshmi. She can speak about what is going to happen and how in future AI is going to contribute to us genomic research.
Thank you, Usha and Jyoti. Thank you, Usha and Jyoti, for the perspective you laid on deep learning and the exercises that you took the participants through. I would like to conclude with a few layers of work that the different sectors in genomics have been addressing and why it necessitates deep learning. I could talk from the experience of us doing genomics every day in and out at the level of clinic, and also the difficulties in analysis of the huge data set that we give. So you sequence a cancer genome or a disease of a neurodegenerative patient or a neuropsychiatric patient or a patient of a rare disease. It's a human genome at the end of the day. And after filtering, you get at least 30 GB of data. After removing the noise and all, you end up with a good volume of data. Now, in the data, what are the actual challenges which people face, and where does it invite machine learning experts, particularly the ones with deep learning? We'll look at it in the case of biological and clinical interpretations, and again in the case of healthcare interpretations. The different types of sequencing that happen today are, when I want to sequence the entire genome, I do something called a whole genome sequencing. I just want to look at the changes in expression at the gene level, I do something called an mRNA sequencing, because as we saw, we look only at the transcribed genes and look at a portion that is coding. When you want to look at areas which are particularly, if I want to learn the effect of influence of the environment, the influence of the environment on say a big project which goes on with children of alcoholics, how much of that stress transfers into this genome? IT employees, how much of stress is encoded in the genome? These are environmental responses. I look at where the regions where proteins bind to DNA and pull those regions alone and do a sequencing. If I want to do hereditary studies like psychiatry, is it in the family? Shall we take three generations and siblings and then sequence? I look at the coding exonic regions. We saw exons and introns. Then we do something called exome sequencing. Today we are moving ahead to something called microbiome, which is the microbes of the gut, to take and sequence the microbiome and look at whether they'll have effect in the brain disorders. So there are multiple levels of sequencing that we do and the multiple sizes of data that we end up with in all these things. Why do we actually require this? And where are we advanced today? We do this at the level of bulk cells. I take a tumor, collect all the cells together from the tumor and sequence. Because there is a heterogeneity, even when a pathologist cuts and gives a tumor, not all cells are cancer cells. There are non-cancer cells there. So there is an intratumoral heterogeneity there. So the result that I get is a statistical bias of how much of them really represented the tumor quality. So the population is heterogeneous. Will the mathematical model or the algorithm and the statistical definitions that I have been making so far in genome analysis be useful at all? No. Can I look at the situation and predict models based on the genome? I don't want a pre-biased model. Today, if I were to predict the transcription binding site or something, I use the position weight matrices. I do the HMM, the hidden Markov models. We use Bayesian algorithms significantly. But can something be model based which can develop and learn on the basis of the data set that I am giving, which is complex, I cannot predict. More so now as we are moving at a single level from cell to cell, there is a huge variation. So I have to adapt to these variations with deep learning methods are very easily predicting. Dr. Jyothi was talking about precision medicine. It not only supports the doctor for the diagnosis or the therapy, like what she said about the clot. Many people with lung cancer are usually given a drug called cetuximab, which does not respond to people who carry a mutation called KRAS. That's why the mutation detection exercise was given. In cases of those, in cases of detection of specific variants that a person takes, or more particularly, if I scan a specific population. Today we are moving towards population genomics based studies. Initially, if you look 10 years back, the studies were on Andamanese tribes, Alaskan populations, and different tribes in different parts of the world to see how their genome differs. Now we are taking them in the clinical perspective also, because there is a heterogeneous mix of populations across. Has somebody carried a mutations on to the other areas? If you look at Mizoram today, the highest percentage of gastric cancer is recorded in those areas. The understanding is that there is a condensed tobacco usage. That story is now, every house will start telling such story. But where are we actually to use these? Particularly when we are doing population-based studies. In India, there are very big studies. The NIMHANS and the Tata Institute, NCBS, have taken up a huge study on brain disorders, schizophrenia patients, bipolar disorder patients, patients who have obsessive compulsive disorder, because the brain is not invasive. And for a psychiatric patient, imaging is not something which is going to differ so that you can identify something. So from the peripheral blood, mononuclear cells, exomes are sequenced. They choose families where at least three of them have this disease. So there is an inherent familial history here. Can I use the familial history information in order to predict specific variants that are prevalent in India? Because some of them respond very well. In such cases, there is a property of responders versus non-responders. Who will respond based on the genomic profile? It's being indicated. That's a very interesting project. If you look at something that the Tata Trust has initiated with UCSD and all over India, the main problem in India they have taken is malaria. They are trying to address diseases. Malaria is now much under control in pockets, but everybody knows that it is about the mosquitoes that bite. So if you have to go, we have to go and kill all the mosquitoes. But can one re-engineer the genome so that they are refractory to biting and cause this is what genome editing people are working on, while one has to do the, this is the anopheles mosquito which gives this, right? So people are now taking pockets of mosquitoes across different parts of India and are sequencing them, getting their draft and say what is specific about Indian mosquito that you should target there. So when we want to edit genome, there are very many genome editing techniques which have come in called the CRISPR-Cas9 strategies. But one should know, one can edit, knock out, knock in, put something in, alter the genome. But I should know what the effect of this knockout or knock in will be on this. That is where at the single cell level, RNNs are heavily employed because of the heterogeneity that they can easily pick up. While CNNs, again I said, are used for smaller stretches, RNNs are exclusively, people generally say we used deep learning. Other cases, in schizophrenia-based studies, where the onset is even at the level, I have a collaborator in Exeter at UK, Prof. Jonathan Mill, who uses this for identification of very, very different variants across twins. Of the two children born, one has schizophrenia and one doesn't have. And this measurement happens at the 30th day of the child's birth. So huge projects that are happening are about sequencing newborn babies. That will be the future. So Harvard has taken up something called Seekaboo, where they have taken 44,000 children. It's called the sequencing a baby for optical outcomes, where one can detect abnormality in syndrome, which would show up at a later stage, but they are inherent in the genome, about hearing disorders. And all these, they have migrated from the traditional Bayesian and other classifications into DLS. So in particular, population genomics, where we start sequencing huge populations, DLL is very, very applied. But where does it actually impact healthcare in the future? One prescribes a drug. We do not know what is the outcome of a particular therapy on a patient. There are several patients who do not respond. If you look at the chemotherapy cycle, after two cycles, the patient starts responding because there is a drug resistance which sets in. So pharmacogenomic approaches invest a lot in deep learning approaches. These are where the future of the healthcare, as well as biological findings, as well as other related structures, are moving towards. And I would like to finish with one particular case. There were a set of people from liquor company here. They had gone, I thought. Something exciting came up 4 days back on how black liquor is converted to pulp and others, where they have taken up huge amount of microbial sequencing. I thought I'll end up there. But today's genomics is not only about genome sequencing. It's about proteomic data. Proteomic data, genomic data, NLP on the prescriptions given, the video processing, the text processing, and the audio processing, particularly in neurodegenerative diseases. The patient is captured and the audio and the video are captured. So there is processing of multi-omic data at the biological level and medical observations plus imaging. So this is where deep learning comes to interpret them exactly as a multidimensional data structure which is used in diagnosis and healthcare. So we might get into using more precision algorithms to arrive at this. So far as the human body remains complex, technologies will continue to evolve. Thank you very much.
It may be proprietary, right? For example, you have to release somebody's genomic data out in the public, you have to have the consent, right? At present, the universities and research institutes work with the consent, saying that they're doing basic research, okay? So the whole idea of privacy, and people can see, the thing is, you cannot patent genes or genomic sequences, right? So the whole idea is there is still a gap, how much to release to the public and how much is proprietary, how much. So there's so many things, the policy is not right in place. So the whole idea is what is released to public is bits and pieces. But you have lot of data available in open source, you can start working on it. Once you have shown that you have a right kind of model, you can always talk to the university, or they will eventually release it, but that will take time. But there is something in outside that is 1,000 genome. There are so many places. Kaggle has some data sets. As I told you, the policy is not in place, and there is a question of privacy, confidentiality, all that. See, major research institutes like CDFD, CCMB, and all that, they are doing a lot of work, but nothing is released. If anything comes out, they make a paper out of it. That's it. But you don't have easy access to Indian genome, no.
I would like to answer this part of it. A huge effort has been initiated in India to release the genomic data from Indian population. One effort that has already started is to sequence the typical Indian genome. So genome India of 10,000 individuals is now being taken up by 22 institutes. And this will be out in public for everyone. But the disease type of data that you asked about, when published, the current rule is that you have to deposit the raw data and then do it. So there are consortia called psych encode for the schizophrenia-like data. There is something called common mind to look at brain disorder-like data. There are consortia to which you need to write and explain why you need it. It's a simple thing. You need to say that it is a not-profit and that you want to work on this experiment and that you will not request the patient privacy data, then you have access to data. I work on such data, which is submitted, gotten up. The moment you spot a typical Indian genome database, you can always write to the consortium there. It doesn't have to be in India. If it's published, it goes to the consortium. Look at ENCODE, look ENCODE, Encyclopedia of DNA Elements and others, which have quite a lot of data from Indian subsets. Because today we cannot publish without depositing that data. More so from the cancer side also in TCGA. All that we need is to get the regulatory approvals for access. It's becoming very easy without spending 1 rupee on that. Repositories to come through, where even the AI data, AI-based data that come is being put up. There's a national machine being developed there. That's very, very important because we as researchers feel the immense need of such data sets at all, which are not generally available. So I go and make requests and get this from the consortia. At least the consortia exists today. It was not there before 2-3 years. That we could just not have. It will be an interesting work, but you do not even know whether it's from male population or from female population, who are the responders. Now we are getting such data here. But yours is a very valuable suggestion. The government is appearing to be listening now. Let's see how it takes.
And one more thing, the thing is, many of this institute has a good repository. They have, for example, CCMB, which is in Hyderabad, it has looked at different tribes, different population, people from different origin. They have taken samples and they have done whole genome sequence for them. And it is there with the information is with the institute, but it is not going to give it to public until unless there is a big why or big something it's going to give. Because the thing is privacy, first thing is privacy. There's a difference between image and gene. There's a difference. Yeah, image. It's okay. Everyone, if you take an X-ray of somebody, the image will look the same. Okay? So there's a difference between image and gene. Okay? As I spoke about one person difference, each of us differ from the other person by 1%. That 1% is different from with reference to other people. So the one there's so much of variation in our gene pool. Gene pool is nothing but at this time point, the whole world population, whatever gene is that, that's a gene pool. The gene pool keeps changing yearly at every point. So the whole thing is, they're not going to release easily. As she said, there's a possibility that you can request. But again, the format will be in that format that it's not easy to convert into your modeling. So you will need a domain expert person so that you can do that. So we have lot of data, but it is not easily available. That's a whole point. But you can always start with your 1,000 genome. There's so much of things available, bits and pieces. And NCBI also has, for gene-wise, you have gene-wise data, but it whole genome you won't find it. So you can actually, there is, at least raw material is there for to start. We need the right models. If the right models are there, people are going to release the data to you. But it's not like any other stream where you get data easily, like financial or banking or any other. This biological information is something, you know, data is oil, yes, and genomic data is, it's yours, right? The big question is whom the gene belongs to. You may carry the gene. I have taken the gene, I have taken your blood and I have sequenced it. Does it belong to me now? See, there are a lot of ethical questions which are very unclear. So it's going to take some time for everything to be out in the public. Even if it is released, it will be released in bits and pieces. You won't get the complete data.
Deadlines that even for a baby, if you need to take blood, you should have an audio or a video consent. So the regulatory authorities are very tough on those things. But the UK has a model when a patient walks into the clinic and signs an informed consent for a biological material, they obtain the consent saying this material could be used for any other study also, but will not be released. So there's a person, a cardiologist uses it for his cardiogenomics project, while a hypertensive measurement is used, though the amount of blood taken will be maximum 10 ml from these patients. These regulatory approvals are very much in place. ICMR has tightened it very well, but the privacy of the data, as you said, is to be coded and distributed wide. That data doesn't exist, but very soon we'll find them in place. The only way to get this, because data science community is very much required to crack and get deeper into this, because people are now, the publications in Nature and Cell, people are revisiting using deep learning approaches to see if I could make out some more information from these. So that will open up a huge opportunity not very far from now.